So when we started off our session, Velfi and Friedrich were talking about Vana being missing as we were walking back to the town or to the grove, and Kara overheard. And it seemed like she kind of like shut down and got like worried about Vana and unhappy that we lied to her or didn't tell her that Vana was missing. And Velfi talked to the professor about the dreams that she was having and how they were not prophetic, but like definitely relating to things that were going on. Meanwhile, Ruin continued to have an existential crisis slash crisis of faith relating to or after Velfi almost died, and his patron was talking or saying that Velfi's family were traitors. Let me see. I'm like, things are out of place. I like wrote things and then changed pages. We got back to the town. I went, or Ruin went to the infirmary and looked at, or to put the Mind Flayer head away and put it in Kara's office. And then we came back to, or looked at the other body that had been opened up by a Mind Flayer and the body that had stab wounds all through it, and couldn't get any information because he's not medically inclined, so he didn't know. We then got back to the town center, or the town square, town center, where Kara was sitting off at a table, where the professor went to talk to her, and the conversation did not go overly well. And then Ruin went to tell her that the Mind Flayer head was in her office, and she proceeded to throw up and leave. During that time, we did talk to Golmek, I think Golmek, about Sunshine, about the kid, the stabbing victim. And he kind of directed us to Sunshine, who Velfi went and talked to, and proceeded to trauma bond slash allow her to trauma dump, and she and poor Sunshine ugly cried and handed out sunflower seeds to basically anybody that walked up while she was trauma dumping on Velfi. After and while the trauma dumping was going on, Ruin went and spoke to Oriana briefly, kind of relaying that he understood how she felt about not, the Mind Flayer being under the Mind Flayer's control and not, being able to do anything about Mog's death. After that, Ruin and Friedrich talked to Olsen, who was Spuddy buddies with Spud. And he worked with him in the wheat field, and then Olsen did kind of or say something about they were outsiders, as in like non-order members that were in the or that had come to the Grove or part of the Grove. We're not really sure. Then we went to bed, and each one of us had a dream of some sort. Velfi dreamt about the day that her parents left, and that they had talked to, or her mom had talked to Gibby and he had told her something that there was something better out there, and her father was worried that they would be labeled traitors and worried about Velfi in that regard. Ruin had a dream about Velfi being dead from the Mind Flayer and some shadowy figure pointing at him, which he didn't know what to do with. And then Friedrich dreamt about Beatrice and how he came to have Beatrice, and that she has outlived, very much outlived a goat and is much larger than a goat would normally be. And there was some magic around her that isn't there anymore. In the morning, we got up, we talked to Golmak, and didn't really get any additional information or didn't want to pry before we went out to the wheat field, and we found Kara in the infirmary after an all-night bender, it seemed like. She had some sort of wheat vodka that they specially make at the Grove that she had been drinking out of. And she was very adamant about killing shit. So we left to go kill shit. And we got to the wheat field and heard monkey noises, and that's where we are.
That was perfect. So I need
Okay.
everybody to roll initiative.
Oh shit, we're
Monkey
getting right
initiative.
into it.
Right, that's right.
I forgot that we were getting right into it. Okay, I have. Okay, what
Natural
is
20.
Natural 20.
Or a 22.
22.
Nine.
Nine.
Natural 20 as well for a
Ooh.
23, biatch.
Boom!
And Kara got an 11.
Kara got an 11. Okay. And what was yours, Friedrich? You said 22?
Yeah, 22.
All right. So with that, three out of the four of the whatever these monstrosities that are just rattling this container, this wooden container, notice when you all walk up. One that is on the right-hand side closest to you does not realize at all. He is still just shaking and screaming at this wagon, and the wagon is made of wood, and it looks to be some kind of like produce carrier. And you all would know that this kind of carrier like has a protective like box in it to make sure that, you know, the goods don't get damaged on the way back to the farm. And with this initiative, I need you all to roll a perception check.
Okay, perception. Okay, that's make that plus five.
Seven.
Seven.
19.
19.
Oh God. Seven for me and a six for Kara.
Friedrich, you notice something in the field to the left. That is like a lot of potatoes and some like other vines that come up really high
Not the
as well.
potatoes.
But you notice whatever this thing is, it's creepy, and you get a sense of absolute dread and death whenever you look its way.
Because of a potato? You said I saw potatoes.
It's in the field with the potatoes and the
Oh, I was
high
really
vibes.
confused.
No,
It's a death
it's not a
potato.
giant death potato. No, so this thing, it's got a hood on it, and it doesn't have its face towards you. It doesn't like it's like even notice that you're there, but with rolling that high and being a wizard from the school of necromancy, this thing is reeking necrotic energy, and it's almost like as soon as it starts to walk a little bit, all of the plants and all of the organic matter around it, just all the life seems to drain from it.
Is it a humanoid?
It looks like it's a humanoid, Like, it looks like it stands on 2 feet, looks like it's got a bodily structure, but if it's a humanoid or not, you're not 100% sure yet. Because it is not looking at you.
How far away is it?
It's about 50 feet away from you.
Hey, you.
You're going to scream at it?
I'm going to try to get its attention.
All right. All of these other...
I mean, I'm assuming, does it see us?
It had its back to you.
Yeah. Oh, never mind.
It does not notice you yet. However, are you screaming at it or no?
No, that was like a flashback where Friedrich was like, what if I screamed at it? And then sucked back to the current time. And I'm like, no, that'd be a bad idea.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so it's just kind of walking, not really noticing anything at the current moment. Its back is to you. It's got a hood. It's got a cloak on. But you get a sense of necrotic energy just leaking from it.
And stuff's like dying around it.
Is dying around it as it walks.
Do I see anything else? Any other people or creatures or anything?
You don't see any other creatures. You see the four monstrosities that are in front of you, in front of this wagon. And the one that is in front of you to the right, the closest to you on the right, is still screaming at whatever is about this wagon. The other three have all of their attention towards you and have started getting quiet as they are just looking at you.
How close are Velfi and Ruin to me?
You guys are all like very close-knit right now.
I'm just going to point in the direction of the necrotic creature just to try to draw it to their attention. But not saying anything, just pointing.
And with pointing, the rest of you would be able to see it. The monstrosities that notice you haven't done anything yet. They are just staring, almost like they're calculating what to do with you. Their heads kind of tilt, almost like they're not the most intelligent beings. Like they're just like the puppy tilt.
Can I tell if they see that thing?
Can what?
Can I tell if the creatures see whatever that odd being is? Have they acknowledged it in any way?
With a 19, you can't tell if they're just not paying it attention, if they don't know it's there, or if, you know, they're on friendly terms. You don't know.
Do the creatures appear to be armed?
They are all armed with short swords.
I'm going to put two and two together and think that's who we're looking for.
Monkey things with short swords. Great.
Stabby monkey
with short swords.
So. Okay. I'm thinking. I'm whispering now. I don't want to draw that thing's attention. I think we've already drawn these creatures' attention. Is the thing walking? You said it's walking. Is it walking towards the cart that the creatures are around? Is it like converging with them, or is it just walking off on its own?
It's walking off on its own.
Is it leaving?
Whether it's leaving or if it's just kind of passing its time, you don't know.
Well, it's gonna notice us one way or the other, because if they do anything, it's gonna notice that there's things. If we do anything, we know that these are what killed Spud, or we can assume these are what killed Spud, because there's a bunch of short sword wielding monkeys.
Right. I think I said this last session because the slot is used, but I'm going to cast Mage Armor on myself.
Yeah, you already had it.
Okay, cool.
And with that, the three that notice you are going to scream. And then the one that hadn't noticed you yet, that's on the right side of the cart, that's closest to you on the right-hand side, is going to whip its head around and notice you as well. And the thing that was in the field, hearing that scream and that it's different than what they were just doing previously, is slowly gonna start turning around. And it's just gonna face all of you. And when it faces all of you, you see a gray, saggy face, mouth wide open, no teeth, sunken in black holes for eyes. And you're just going to hear a low shriek. And Ruin, it is your go.
Yeah, you know what? I think I'm going to go over here. Over to the other side there. I'm going to move right up here and get right in. Right in with one of these monkeys.
Okay.
And I'm going to, as my bonus action, cast a spell. I'm going to cast Spirit Shroud. Which I call forth spirits of the dead, which flit around me. It's a concentration and I deal extra damage when I hit things. It's going to be radiant damage.
Nice. So this is similar to like a Spirit Guardians, but like undead.
Yeah, but it's nice. But it's on attack. But it's on attack, so it's okay. Not a. And I'm going to. Oh, and any creature that takes damage can't regain hit points until the start of my turn. Or any creature that takes damage from me can't take. And then I'm going to jump back over to roll 20. I'm going to attack the blue one.
Get it.
Twice with my sword.
Okay, go for it.
Yeah. If I had used Hexblade's curse, that would have been a crit, because that's a 19 on the die.
That hits.
But I didn't use it. So that's a 27 total and a 19 for the two attacks.
For the damage or for the...
No.
Okay.
No, for the attack. Yeah, I rolled both of my attacks at the same time.
Both of those hit, yes.
So I roll... So I need to roll... Holy moly. I need to do math. Okay, I need to roll 2d8 for each one of the attacks. Because... So... rolled low on that one. The first attack is 10 damage. Three of that's radiant, if that matters. If it doesn't, then it doesn't.
No, it does not matter.
Okay. The other one is 11 damage.
Nice.
And only one of that's radiant.
Okay. Cool. So you swipe with your sword and you can see, like, as you're swiping, it cuts deep on blue and you hear like almost like a ape monkey yell from it as you heard it. Is there anything else you'd like to do on your turn?
I mean, I've used my action and my bonus action and done the moving. I think I'm good.
And I do have to ask, is Ruin considered medium or large?
I think it's medium. I'll look, but I'm gonna go with medium right now. I believe it says medium in the end.
Perfect. Thing. With that, Friedrich, you are up.
Okay, with creepy flesh book in one hand and wand in the other, I'm gonna launch a ray of frost out at orange in front of me.
All right, going for orange.
I'm gonna use my inspiration. Come on. Much better. Does a 19 hit?
19 hits.
Good, because that was a natural one before. Okay. Oh, two ones. It takes... Where is it at? Oh, it takes 2 points of frost damage. However, its speed is reduced by 10 feet until the start of my next turn.
Nice. Okay. All right. Is there anything else you'd like to do on your turn?
Yeah, I'm actually just going to sidestep out a little bit. Where's my selector? Here we go. About 15 feet over here. There we go. And that'll be my turn.
And I am medium.
Okay, you are medium. Perfect. All right, with Friedrich's go, it is now Orange's turn, but Orange cannot really get there, so it is actually going to try something. It is going to use its action to shadow teleport right next to the person who hit it.
Who's that?
You. And since that is all it can do on its turn, that is it. But now it is Red's turn. And Red is actually going to use its action to dash. Let's see, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45. To Velfi. And with that, that's all it can do. It is now the creepy thing in the corner's turn. So with that, it's going to use its movement. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. And it is going to use its action. Withering Gaze. One creature that the Bodak can see within 60 feet of it must make a DC 13 Constitution saving throw. And it is going to choose Friedrich, since Friedrich is in front of him. And I need you to make a Constitution saving throw.
Con save of 13 or more?
Of 13 or more.
Hey, 19.
19, you did save. But you will take half as much damage.
Oof.
And that is going to be 9 necrotic damage to you.
You know what's unfortunate? As a necromancer, I'm not resistant to necrotic damage. But I guess that's life.
Oh no. Oh no.
You should have been the Asimar that's resistant to necrotic damage.
I wanted to be an old orc man.
It is going to use a death gaze. When a creature that can see the Bodak's eyes, Velfi, have you looked at it?
Don't think so. Like, I looked in the direction when the professor pointed it out.
Okay.
But I don't think I stayed looking at it.
You can avert your eyes from it. So if you're not still looking at it, if you do decide to attack it, that attack will be a disadvantage. Because if you look at it, I'm gonna need you to make a saving throw.
Okay.
And as a bonus action, it is going to activate an Aura of Annihilation.
Sounds healthy.
The aura deals 5 necrotic damage to any creature that ends in its turn within 30 feet of the creature. Next up is Kara.
Oh God. I'm Kara. Oh God. She's going to move 10 feet up this way. And I'm going to summon the Wildfire Spirit, like, right. It's going to go right there just because that's where the square is, but it's kind of in between the two of these guys.
Okay.
And when it appears, they need to make, I need to read this. They need to make a I'm going to not be dumb. It's going to be more up here. So it's not directly in line with Ruin. And can get hit and hit him. Each creature within 10 feet of the spirit needs to make a dexterity saving throw. It is a DC 15.
Blue made a 5. And pink made a 6.
Fantastic. They're going to take 2d6 fire damage as it, like, explodes into existence. 7 fire damage to both of them. I guess it's gonna flame seed the flame seed blue.
Okay.
And it's not going to hit.
Okay. Is it a natural one?
No.
Okay.
It's let me just figure. What is the Oh, it uses my my spell. A 13. Well, does a 13 hit?
A 13 meets it, beats it.
Oh, well, apparently it's gonna do damage. 1d6 plus 6 fire damage to Blue.
Blue is not looking very good.
And that is the end of Kara's turn, and she is going to make sure that she's not looking directly at the spooky scary man.
Alrighty. And with that, Velfi, you're up.
Okay. So I think Velfi is going to cast Bane at first level.
Okay.
And she's going to include the one in front of Friedrich, the one in front of me, and the, what did you call it, Bodek?
Yeah, it's called a Bodek.
Bodek. All three are within the 30 feet, so we're going to cast Bane. So they need to make a charisma saving throw of 16.
All right, so red is going to fail. Orange is going to fail. And the Bodak is also going to fail. So they are all baned.
Yeah. So now they got to roll a d4 and subtract the number from attack rolls or saving throws.
Awesome. Sounds great. Anything else to do on your turn?
Jeez, I can't do anything. No.
All right, sounds good. With that, it is now Pink's go, and Pink is going to use its short sword on this wildfire spirit to try and hit it, and that is going to be a 22 to hit.
Hits.
All right, and that is going to be 9 points of piercing damage and 2 points of necrotic to the wildfire spirit.
The wildfire spirit, okay, it's not happy about it.
It's not happy about it, but it's still going. All right. And next up is Blue. And Blue is actually going to try and hit you with a weapon attack. Does a 24 hit?
It do.
It does. All right. And it is going to give you not too much damage, only 4 bludgeoning. I need you to make a strength saving throw at disadvantage.
At disadvantage?
Mm-hmm.
Oakley doakley. A6.
A6. So you are currently grappled. Grappled.
Okay. So that means my speed is 0, right?
That means your speed is 0.
Okay. So it doesn't say that I can't. Okay. Cool. It doesn't say that I can't hit him. It just means that I can't go anywhere.
It means, yeah, you Fantastic. Can't go anywhere. You can't benefit from any bonus to its speed. The condition ends if the grappler is incapacitated. The condition also ends if an effect removes a grapple creature from the reach of the grappler or grappling effect, such as a thunder wave spell. But you are currently grappled. And with that, Ruin, it's your turn.
I have to make a concentration check to make sure that I maintain concentration on my spell.
Nice.
Okay. Since that spell just stays up, I'm going to bonus action Hexblade's Curse on the on Blue, because he's right here. And then I just have to read this real quick to make sure that I do. Okay, cool. So I crit. I'm going to attack him with my sword because I'm grappled, so there's nowhere else for me to go. But
I will say your attack is at disadvantage because he is kind of trying to grapple you to where, like, your arms are kind of stuck.
Okay.
Yeah, so this will be at disadvantage.
All right, so first attack, is, oh my god, math. That is a Hexblade's Curse. 15.
A 15 hit does hit.
With disadvantage?
With disadvantage, okay. Yep.
Then I'm going to roll my 2d8 damage. That is 11, 12, 13, 14.
How would you like to do this?
He's gonna start grappling me. I'm gonna just like put my sword in between him and me, so he ends up grappling my sword.
Nice. Okay, cool. Yeah, so as like it's trying to grapple you, it doesn't realize you've put your sword in front of you, and it stabs itself and impales itself on your sword, and it's just hanging there limply.
And then I guess I'm gonna go, since he's dead and I can move, I'm gonna move over here. Would that make me have to like do any sort of check to kind of go around the
make an acrobatics cart? Check if you're wanting to, because right now you're on the cart.
Right. Okay. I was just trying to move to get advantage, but that's a 19 on the die, so.
Yeah, I'll say you're able to very easily, cool, like hop on. You're pretty tall, so you're able to hop on top of this this wagon. However, when you do, it feels heavy. So when you land on it, it feels heavy. Like heavier something than an empty cart. Like there's something in it.
Oh, because they were like attacking something in the cart, right?
You can make an assumption.
Oh, okay. So they were doing something with the cart. I don't know what it was.
Yeah.
The cart is heavy. I'm going to like step on the cart. I'm going to like step on the cart and be like, that's weird. Oh, look, guy to hit. And I'm going to use my, because I only used one attack and I get two a turn. So I'm going to go ahead and attack I'm going to attack Pink since he's hanging out over here with me and Fireboy. That ends up being a 19.
Yes, and that means you crit, right?
No, because blue was Hexblade's Cursed, and it was 19 total.
Gotcha, 19 total. It was 19 total. That definitely hits.
Rolling it low on damage. That is only 10 damage. I say only, and I'm dealing 10 damage on a, 10 damage.
Perfect. Is there anything else you like to do on your turn?
I use my bonus. Nope.
Alrighty.
I'm kind of glad that I'm facing whatever that thing is back, because it's not looking at me. Ha ha!
It is not looking at you.
I'm going to turn to orange and snap my little fingers and see the ghostly bell appear as I cast Toll the Dead on it. It's a 14 wisdom save.
14 wisdom save. Alrighty. It is not very wisdomous. Nope, fails with 12.
I think wise is the word.
Wisdomous is the word now.
Wisdomous. I like wisdomous. We're going to go with wisdomous.
Okay. So it's going to take, and it's missing HP,
it
right?
It is.
Okay, so it takes 2d12. Of necrotic. Here we go. Big money. A 12 and a 2. 14 necrotic damage.
14. Alrighty. 14 necrotic damage. With that, is there anything else you'd like to do on your turn?
No, I don't think Friedrich could have any reason to disengage from it, so no, that'll be my turn.
Okay. Now you will take the 5 points of necrotic from the Aura of Annihilation.
Can I tell where it's coming from?
You would be able to tell where it's coming from, since it's like the ground is now coming up with the necrotic energy and the grass is starting to fade away and like almost like ash is coming from the ground.
Can I see, is it just at to where I am or does it go past me? Can I tell the area that's affected by it?
You will know now that you've been hurt by it. It's this 30-foot square where you see like ashes coming, or not square, but circle, where ash is coming up. And
so I see like the difference in the ground.
You can.
Inside versus outside. Okay. You said it was 5 points.
Just because would I, because I like when you did that circle, I was like roughly in that circle. Would I take that?
You
like,
would take okay. it as well. So would the wildfire spirit. And so would Akara. And so would Velfi.
Did any of the monkeys go after it?
It would hit the monkeys as well. Is there anything else you like to do on your turn, though, Friedrich?
No, that's my turn.
With that, it is Orange's go. He's going to attack Friedrich. And that is going to be a 22 to hit.
Yeah, he hit me.
You take...
I'm an old Sinan man.
4 points of bludgeoning damage.
Heard.
I need you to make a DC 13 strength saving throw at disadvantage. It's trying to grapple you.
It's trying to hug you.
Strength? DC 13 at disadvantage. That's a failure. It's a 9.
All right. You have been what is known as garroted. You are currently grappled.
Oh, jeez.
Garroted? Or garroted, or how to...
G-A-R-R-O-T-E.
Isn't that where you, like, cut someone's neck with a piano wire, that's, or am I thinking of like, something else? Yeah, that's where they, like, grab you. Neck.
Yeah.
You just stick your thumbs in. Yeah.
So with that, Orange is over. It is now Red's go, and Red is going to try to attack Velfi. I do not think an 11 hits.
No.
Okay, so that is its turn. It tried to do the same thing to you that happened to Friedrich, but it missed. And with that, it is now the Bodak's turn. And with it being the Bodak's turn, it is going to slowly start making its way 5, 10, 15, 20,
25, 30 to Kara. Oh, shit.
And it's going to try and hit her with its very almost decaying hand. And that is going to be an 18 to hit.
Yep. Kara's got an AC of 10.
And that is going to be 4 bludgeoning damage.
Okay.
And 14 necrotic.
Well, okay then.
Perfect. And with that, it is going to be its go. Is Kara still avoiding the gaze of this thing? Or is she looking at it since it hit her?
I don't know if she would know that you can't look at it. I mean, if something walked up in front of... I guess she'd be looking at it.
Okay.
I mean,
roll me a constitution saving throw.
Yeah. That is a 13.
That meets it, beats it.
Hey.
And nothing seems to happen.
Fantastic.
As its face tilts and its mouth gets bigger, like an abyss hole is starting to just open very wide. You don't see a tongue, you don't see teeth, you just see a black abyss in its mouth. And that's its go. With that, it is Kara's turn.
Cool. The first thing that's going to that is going to happen is I have to do things. Wait. Is that okay? Perfect. The spirit is going to go and occupy the same space as Kara, because it can, and use fiery teleportation.
Okay. And is that within 5 feet or 10 feet?
Spirit can, and each willing creature of my choice within 5 feet of it teleport 15 feet away to an unoccupied space.
And that does damage when it leaves, doesn't it?
It does damage. Yeah. It's within 5 feet.
Okay. Within I just want to make sure Velfi wasn't in that
of
too.
The space.
All right.
Within 5 feet of the space.
And what kind of save are we making?
Fire damage. Dexterity.
Dexterity for the Bodak. I believe that that fails with an 8.
15. I'm just trying to figure out 15. Okay. I will roll that damage. That is 7 fire damage. And
you will notice it does not do as much damage as you thought.
That's fine. But that leaves Kara's action to do a thing. Can I like have them in separate spot like that?
Yeah, that's fine.
Space wise, so you can see them both. Okay. They're in the same place, but just Kara for her action is going to cast a thing. It's just gonna be the regular old moonbeam.
Okay.
Centered right on the Bodak.
All right.
And it needs to make a DC 15 Constitution save.
Constitution save. That fails with a 5.
So it's going to take 2d10 radiant damage.
Okay.
That is 14 radiant damage.
And you will notice that that takes the full amount as this moon light just starts to burn away at its skin. But you will still notice that the aura of annihilation is still around it. And the grass still looks like bits of ash are coming from the ground all the way up to the sky. Like it's just floating upwards. Is that all Kara would like to do with her turn?
That is all Kara would like to do with her turn. And yep, I know they're, yep.
Okay, 5 points of necrotic.
5 points of necrotic to both of us.
So it's just damage. There's no save or anything on that.
There is no save on that.
Oof.
And with that, it is Velfi's turn.
Okay.
Did Pink want to take an attack of opportunity on the spirit, the fire spirit, because it did move out of space?
Okay, so it didn't just like teleport to her. All right, so thank you.
I gotta. Yep.
16.
Yep.
Plus 5 to 21 to hit. That's going to be 4 points of piercing damage.
Okay.
And 4 points of necrotic.
Cool. The spirit is not looking good.
Okay.
Not looking good.
And with that, Velfi, it is now your turn.
All right. So, I'm going to cast. I'm going to cast Vicious Mockery.
Okay.
On red.
On red. All right. Let's go.
On red. Oops. What did I do? Oh, I didn't do anything. Okay. All right. 4, 5, 6. That is 6 psychic damage.
All right, I'm going to save that, to that, right?
Delicious
Mockery?
Yes, wisdom save of 16.
Wisdom save of 16. That fails. So how many points?
Six.
6, perfect. And that was on red. Awesome, awesome, awesome. And is there anything else you'd like to do on your turn?
Yes, I'm going to cast Bardic Inspiration on Ruin. And 60 feet, right? Yeah. And that shall be my turn.
All right. With being that close to the Bodak, you take 5 points of necrotic damage as well. And with that, it is now Pink's go. Pink sees Ruin right there. Pink is going to try to attack Ruin. All right. And let's see. It does not hit with the 7. And it's going to just squeal because it's angry. And you're going to hear, like, with that squeal and having being on top of this wagon, you're going to feel something roll. And with that, it is Pink's go. So, or Pink's done. So it's Blue's turn. Blue is dead. So now it's Ruin's turn.
So I feel something roll.
You felt something roll in the wagon.
Okay.
And, like, you had to, like, adjust your footing to make sure you didn't, like...
Would looking... Because I'm, like, standing on the wagon. Would, like, looking into the wagon... I'm not trying to, like, search through it, but, like, looking down into the wagon be, like, take up my action or anything like that?
It would, because it's very tightly sealed.
Then I'm going to continue to attack... Pink, because... Oh, did Pink take the damage from the...
Yep. Yep. Pink and Red did.
Pink and Red. Okay, so I'm going to attack it with my sword. Going to use the same dice that I've been using so I don't get them confused. Hey! One's a natural 20, but the other one misses. Oh, wait. Hold on. I might, because I have two inspiration right now. Do I want to use... Is Bardic a D8?
Yes.
Plum? D8, okay. Yep. Well, you know what? I'll use the D8, and then I'll see whether or not I want to use my inspiration. That turns into a 5, so that's a 13.
13 meets it, beats it.
Well, fantastic. So I have a natural 20 to... take care of first. How did I lose my dice already? I was using... Oh, wait, it's literally right in front of me. Ooh, that's a solid... 13... doubled... 26...31 damage on the crit.
How would you like to do this?
I'm just gonna, like, cut him in half, I guess.
Nice. As you take this attack, you literally cut it in half. The legs stand there and the body just goes, like, 10 feet off, like, to the north as you completely separate it. What else would you like to do on your turn?
So that was one attack... Oh, well, no. I mean, so technically I had a second attack because I had the natural 20.
Mm-hmm.
So that other attack is... But I don't want to... Since that's dead, I think I'm going to... Now knowing that if I'm within 30 feet of that thing... If I'm within 30 feet of Bojack Horseman, I'm going to take damage. So I'm going to measure things. There's 25, so if I go up here, yeah, Ruin's going to go over yonder. Oh, I didn't know you could do that. Ruin's going to go over yonder. I think it's right there. Puts me at 35 feet because I can't do anything else, so I'm going to hide in the potatoes.
Give me a stealth check.
Oh, well, Ruin's stealth isn't great, I don't think. That's a 12.
Okay, cool. You feel good about yourself.
I think I'm a potato.
You feel good. You feel great.
Even though I'm standing over the top of the potatoes and everybody can see me, I am a potato. Nobody pay attention to me.
And with that, Friedrich... You are up.
Hey, okay. Let's see here. I'm right on the edge.
You are also grappled right now. Your speed is 0.
Yeah, I can't move. Yeah. How do you break a grapple?
You can use your action to try to break with a strength DC at disadvantage.
What can I do otherwise? Am I considered incapacitated?
You're not considered incapacitated. You can still cast a spell because nothing's covering your mouth. And you could try to attack it with something, but it would be a disadvantage.
So I can cast this even if the spell is somatic? Can I do that?
Somatic?
Doesn't that mean I gotta like move a finger or something?
Yeah, so if it's a roll to hit, let's just say it's at disadvantage. If not, everything else is normal.
Okay, well, I gotta get Monkey off of me, so I'm gonna cast Toll the Dead on it again, and it's a 14 wisdom save.
14 wisdom save.
Would you say you've got to get a monkey off your back?
Yes, it fails.
That was good. Okay. It fails. Cool. 2d12 of necrotic, which are kind of shit. 9 points of necrotic damage.
It is not looking good. It is not looking good, but you are still currently grappled. And with that, it is now Orange's turn.
Can I? I can't. I have to use a full action to try to get out of it.
Yes.
Okay. I'll stay.
And with that, since you are still grappled and it is got you in a chokehold, you're going to take 8 points of bludgeoning damage.
Damn.
Heard.
And it is going to use its action to... Well, actually, wait 1 second. Let's see if it's recharged. It is. It's going to use its action to shadow teleport with you.
Do I... I'm right at the edge of 30 feet. I also take the necrotic damage too, don't I?
Yes, you take the 5.
So 13 total. 8 bludgeoning and 5 necrotic.
Yes.
Heard. Whisk me away, monkey.
And with that, it's going to shadow teleport far north. Friedrich is gone. You don't see where Friedrich went. Friedrich is currently gone.
Oh.
Oh.
Bye.
Oh.
I mean, you know where you went because you're there.
Friedrich knows where Friedrich is.
I know. Can I see anybody from where I am?
You can see them, but you are pretty far off.
Okay. Well, this is interesting.
With that, it is now, let's see, Red's turn. Red is going to try and hit Velfi. And that is going to be a 16 to hit. Does 16 hit?
Is that with the minus 4?
That isn't with the minus 4 yet, but does a 16 hit?
Yes.
All right. Minus a 4. Does a 12 hit?
No.
Nice. Okay. So it tries to reach out for you and tries to wrap something around your neck as well to garrote or garrotes or whatever it is you as well.
Garate.
But it misses because that bane just made it like slip of the finger. And with that, it cannot do anything else. So it is now the Bodak's turn. And let's see, what is the Bodak gonna do?
I'm yelling from the potatoes. You can't see me. I'm invisible. I am a potato.
It does see you.
Oh yeah, I kind of figured.
It sees you with a 19, and it's gonna slowly turn its head to you as you are screaming at it. Are you looking at it? As you scream at it?
Yeah. Yeah, because I don't 100% know that it's not.
I need you to make a constitution saving throw. As this void just looks at you.
That is a 14.
You pass, so it doesn't look like anything happens. But
I can see you too.
It's going to just keep staring at you, almost like it's doing the head tilt. As it doesn't say anything. And I need you to make another constitution saving throw.
Oh boy. That is a 13.
Meets it, beats it. You take, let's see, that is 7 points of necrotic damage as it just stares at you.
No, you have hurt my temporary HP. And my actual HP, but. You said 7?
Yes, 7.
Math. Okay, we're good.
And it's just going to move its full 30 feet this way. And with that, that's its turn. It's Kara's turn now.
Okay. So as an action, Kara's going to move the moonbeam so it's back over top of the Bodak. So it needs to make the constitution save again.
All right. That is a 19. However, it is baned. 15.
15, or meets it, beats it, but it still takes half of 2d10 radiant damage. So it takes 4 after halving.
Okay, cool.
Bonus action. Let's see. Oh wait, I gotta measure. Oh, fantastic. So they're out of range of the thing. The wildfire spirit. So many things to do. What's the range on flame seed? Oh, perfect. 60 feet, and he's 30 feet away. Basic math says I'm gonna throw a fiery seed.
Weird. Okay. Roll to hit.
That is a natural 1.
I need you to roll a d4.
Okay. A 2.
A 2. Velfi was number 2. I need you to roll a d20 again.
Can you roll a 20?
Ruin.
Oh, okay.
That is a
flame seeded.
That is only... Oh, well, actually, no, that's pretty high. That's a 17.
Does a 17 hit Velfi?
Yes.
Oh. That's 9 fire damage because I rolled max damage on the
but
flame
as a tiefling,
seed. I'm
you
so
take
sorry.
Half of that fire damage.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
That's right.
So you take 4.
So it's half a 9.
4.
4.
Okay.
I feel less bad about it, but feel terrible.
So yeah, this flame seed, it looks like it's going in the right direction, but this fire spear almost looks like it sneezes. And the seed accidentally, instead of going straight, goes to the left and hits Velfi for 4 points of fire damage. But with that, is there anything else you would like to do on your turn?
No. And Kara's going to scold the fire spirit for
this fire spirit's gonna have like a look on its face like and just kind of pointing to its nose and like I'm sorry, and then it's just gonna slowly turn to Velfi like it's like trying to mouth I'm sorry.
I feel like it's a little flaming badger just because badgers are Kara's thing.
Yes, I love that. With that, it is now Velfi's go. What would Velfi like to do?
Okay, question.
Yes.
So in my bonus actions, it says 2 weapon fighting.
Yes, so you can have a rapier and like a dagger.
Okay.
Yep.
And I could attack with both of those?
You can attack
with
both of them. It would be an action and a bonus action.
Okay.
I learned that from Baldur's Gate.
What an educational tool.
Dude, Baldur's Gate 3 gives like so much D&D information. It's fantastic.
Yeah, like I had no idea you could do that. But yeah, so you can attack with like a rapier and a dagger as long as you have.
Okay. I think that is exactly what I'm going to do.
Go for it.
I'm going to attack with my rapier first. So that is a natural 1 plus 5.
With a natural 1, would you like to use a point of inspiration?
Okay, yes, I'm gonna use one. I'm gonna use one. That is a 16 plus 5.
That definitely
So that
hits.
Puts me at a 21. Cool, let me just write this down that I have 2 inspo points. Okay, so that does 1d8 of damage plus 2. That's 6 piercing damage.
Okay.
For the rapier. And then for the dagger, that is 10 plus 5.
15, that hits.
15, and then that is 1d4. 1 plus 2, that's 3 piercing damage.
How would you like to do this?
Yes. Okay. So, with the rapier, Velfi is going to slash across its chest. And then, right after she slashes, she's going to take her dagger straight through the eye, right into the brain.
So, yeah, that exact thing happens. And you've got your like hand halfway through its skull as you mash that dagger into its eyeball. And it just slides off and falls backwards, as now red is gone. Is there anything else you like to do on your turn?
Let's see. I know this is gonna put me if I go closer, but I think we're gonna risk it.
Okay.
Yes. I'm going to risk it. So I'm going to jump. What was this? Was 30 feet or was that 30 feet?
That was 30 feet.
This was okay. Yes. This is my final move. So that means I end in the ring.
Yep. So take 5 points necrotic damage.
1, 2, 3, 5. Cool.
And as you all are taking little bits of necrotic damage, I think this is the third time, you will start to see like little black spindles starting to form like on your hands or on your feet as you get closer and closer to this bodak and you keep getting hit with necrotic damage. It almost looks like the tips of your fingers are starting to rot. And with that, it is Ruin's turn.
Ruin is going to, or I am going to move over here because I don't see the professor, so I can't like magically look up that way and see him in the.
And when you do that, I need you to make a constitution saving throw.
For moving forward?
For moving forward.
Okay. That's an 18 on the die.
Nothing happens.
Fantastic. I am going to, since I'm not close range with it, I'm like far enough away that I could Eldritch Blast at it. I'm going to Eldritch Blast at it twice. Okay. That is, what is basic arithmetic? A 13 and an 18.
The 13 misses, but the 18 hits.
I will actually, because I didn't need to use my Bardic last time.
Okay.
Because I didn't have that extra attack, because that's what it was on. Is that cool?
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't want to, like, I will add 5 to the one that missed. Okay, cool. So I get 2d10 plus 2d8, because I still have that Spirit Shroud thing. So roll that one. So that is 10. 14 force damage plus 3 radiant damage. And then the other one is 11 force damage plus another 5 radiant damage.
All right, cool. Anything else you like to do on your turn?
5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. I'm going to take 10 feet of movement back here and then take 5 necrotic damage.
All right, take that 5 necrotic. And it's looking like its face is starting to just fall off, like the skin is just starting to sag, and you can see, like, almost like ash, little pieces of its face are just flaking off, like the grass that you see that is rotting and starting to go to the sky, so is bits of its face.
So he's not doing great. We like to hear that.
And with that, Friedrich, it is your go.
Okay. Well, I'm being choked to death. I'm just gonna struggle a bit. Unhand me, you punk. And then,
unhand me.
I'm sure you call him a punk. Unhand me.
Unhand me, you ruffian.
I guess I'll do Toll the Dead again.
Okay, go for it.
But all I can do, well, it's a wisdom save 14.
Wisdom save 14. All right. Wisdom save of a 14. 17.
Is that with the Bane? Unless he's not Baned anymore. I don't know if the
Does Bane stop whenever they get out of range? Or no? Because I actually do not know.
I don't remember the wording so, on Bane.
As long as concentration isn't broken.
It's 3 creatures of each choice. Oh. I cast it when they were, when it was in range. Roll attack. It doesn't say anything about it.
Okay.
It just says concentration up to 1 minute.
If it doesn't say anything, you're still concentrating. That is a... Does a 14.
Meets it, exceeds it.
Beats it.
Well, the bell does nothing. I'm still stuck. I don't have a bonus action. I don't have any other type of anything.
Are potions an action or bonus action right now? Just for my brain.
So with health potions, if you want to get the full amount, it's a full action. If you want to roll for it, bonus.
Okay, cool.
With my bonus action and to the best of my ability, I'm going to scream as loud as I can. That'll be my turn.
I will say you all hear it and know where Friedrich is now. And with that, it is now Orange's go. And as it's going to pull that bit tighter, you're going to take 14 points of bludgeoning damage.
Is there no roll or anything?
There is no roll for that one. The target takes 2d6 plus 3 bludgeoning damage at the start of each of the thing's turn.
The consciousness fades from Friedrich. Right as I start to slip, I come back to, as I use Relentless Endurance, and come back to 1 HP. But I'm assuming because of that, it's not going to drop its grapple on me.
Do you have to do it immediately?
You do. Yeah, that's what I was reading if I could, like as soon as he runs away, be like, ha, I'm alive. But no, it says if when you're reduced to 0 HP but not killed, you can drop to 1 HP instead. So the way that reads to me is that, like, you never actually drop to 0.
Okay. So if you not drop into 0, it does not move. It's still got you in a chokehold. And it notices that your, like, life is starting to slip away and you just feel it get a little bit tighter around your neck. And with that, that is its turn, and it is now the Bodak's turn. And it is still staring at Ruin. Ruin, are you looking at it or nah?
Oh, yeah.
If you're looking at it, I need you to make a constitution saving throw.
The 12 that landed on the floor doesn't count.
Nah, if it's on the floor, it doesn't count.
No, I'm going to use one of my inspirations because I have two of them right now. Okay, cool. That's a 20 total.
Yeah, so nothing happens. And it's going to just continue to stare at you. And withering gaze, I need another constitution saving throw.
Fantastic. I'm going to use my other inspiration because why not at this point? That is a 18 turns into a 21.
21 beats it. So you will take, 12 points of necrotic damage on that one.
I am going to, because I can when I take damage, because I don't use this often at all. Once I can find a d12 in my pile of die, I'm going to use my, what is it called? Stone's Endurance. So I get to soak up damage, a certain amount of damage. That is, how much do you say I took?
That was 12.
12? Well, I rolled an 11 on the die plus my constitution modifier, so I don't take any damage.
Nice, cool. So it almost, it starts to just slowly stare at you as you do the stone's endurance. And it's almost like it just tilts its head, stares at you for a second, and then slowly turns around and looks at Velfi instead. Velfi, are you looking at it or avoiding its gaze?
Velfi is actually looking at the professor.
Looking at the professor. You don't have to do anything then. And with that, it is the Bodex, or that's the end of the Bodex turn. It is now Kara's turn.
So Kara, let's see. She is in the same space as the wildfire spirit. Oh wait, did the Bodak didn't move anywhere, did it?
It did not.
It needs to make a constitution saving throw again. Because it stayed in the same, or because Moonbeam is still.
Oh, because of Moonbeam. I completely forgot about that. Yeah. That is a 17,
I mean,
but it is still banged. Like, that's a 16.
16. It does still take half damage.
Okay.
So 4 damage.
Let's see, 4?
Yeah.
Cool. It's still standing, but that moonbeam is just frying it. And it's starting to smell like rotten death. Melting, burning, rotting death. At this point.
Okay.
Whatever you want to imagine that smells like.
The fire spirit is going to move us 15 feet. That would be 5, 10, 15. With the fiery teleport. I actually should probably check and make sure that that's not a once a...
Fiery teleport, I'm pretty sure,
nope,
can be used as many
it's
times
every
as
turn.
You want to. Yep.
It's every turn. Okay, cool. And then if she goes, her movement, which is 30, 30, yes, she'd be in range of what's his face, but does that put her in, is that 60 feet? Am I doing basic math correctly? If it's right here. Yeah, right here, that would be, yeah, that's, yes, okay, cool. So healing word would work. Yay, I know how to do math. I don't know what you're talking about. So right there, and she's going to cast healing word very begrudgingly on the professor. Oh wait, never mind, can't do it. Because bonus action is...
If she wants to use her action to cast Healing Word instead of a bonus action, I'm fine with that.
Okay, cool. Because I don't have... Yeah, because she doesn't have heal spells that are... has Cure Wounds, but that's not within range. So she's going to go ahead and use the second... Oh, wait. First third level spell of the day, and is going to give the professor, it's 3, 4, 5, 9 HP. It's not a lot, but that's all she got. And
thank you.
And then she's going to take 5 damage, and the spirit is going to take 5 damage because they're within range.
All right.
And the spirit, the like fiery badger is basic or is pretty much flickered out of existence. It's very, very close to disappearing.
Oh, it hasn't disappeared yet. Okay.
No, it's super close.
So yeah, it's like a candle that's almost done burning. And with that, Velfi, you are up.
Okay. So Velfi is going to cast. Velfi is going to cast Tasha's Mind Whip at third level.
Okay. And what are we aiming that at?
We are aiming that at orange.
Okay, go for it.
And the Bodak.
All right, so are you looking at the Bodak?
I guess because Velfi wouldn't know that looking at it, right? So she would take a look.
No one's been hurt by it. So give me a constitution saving throw.
Okay. Con is 17.
You're fine. You don't notice anything.
Okay. So, intelligence saving throw for both of 16.
All right. Bodak got a negative one.
Yeah.
So Bodak failed.
Smooth brain Bodak.
And the other thing got a 14, but it is still banged. So it actually got a 11. So I think they both fail.
Okay, cool. So on a failed save, they take 3d6 of psychic damage. Oh my god. Really? That's 4.
How would you like to take the Bodak out?
Oh, let's go!
With 4 points of damage! Okay, so you see these kind of like very faint purpley kind of whips lash out of Belfie's hand. So, and you're going to hear a loud crack as it just whips against the Bodak.
Ooh, nice.
Like maybe even like slicing its head off.
Nice. So that just whip is just going to see the purpley whip and it just hits the side of his neck for a second and it looks like nothing happens. But then it just falls off, like slides off. And the Bodak just looks like it turns to ash and just starts to raise into the sky, like all of the little bits of necrotic energy from the grass and everything that it had. And then it's all gonna very quickly crash down. And the Bodak is gone. Is there anything else you'd like to do on your turn?
I'm gonna cast the Bardic Inspiration on the professor, just in case.
Nice.
I feel so much better.
With that, Ruin, it is now your go.
Well, I can... Can I see the thing that's got the professor? I know it's in the potatoes.
Yes, you can see it.
Okay. I just want to make sure before I
will like, say, since thing. It's... If you're trying to hit it, its DC is a little higher because it's got Friedrich right in front of him. So we'll say its DC is 2 points higher.
Okay.
Because it is using Friedrich almost like a shield.
They have half cover behind the old man.
The old man.
Now, I gotta ask it. If I were to move to the other side of it.
You could hit it in its back.
Okay, cool. Then I think I may as well just... Let's do all the things. So I'm going to... Ruin is going to... Go 30. Okay, so from there. Yep. Okay, cool. So he's going to move my movement up here. And then I'm going to bonus action Misty Step. So I'm right behind it. And then I'm gonna attack it. Would I have advantage because I'm technically flanking it, or are we not counting it?
Okay. He's grappled.
Okay. Just so that's a 18
that hits
and a 15 because it's two attacks.
They both hit. How do you want to do this?
I want to garrote it with my sword. Like, put the sword over, like, I assume Ruin's got some sort of, like, gauntlet or something covering, uh-huh. you know, over his hands, and he's just going to pull the sword into the thing, like, into the thing's neck, like, from behind it.
As soon as it hits the skin, you're going to hear it scream, and then it's almost like mid-scream, it just cuts off as you slice its vocal cords, and its head goes with it. And it is now gone. Friedrich, the things around your neck start to loosen.
Thank you. It's been uncomfortable.
There's a time and a place for ties, and that didn't look like it was a comfortable one.
No, but I'm curious what the time and the place is for that.
We're not going to talk about it. There's a thing in the cart.
Yeah, let's go. Let's go check it out. I'll sort of shake myself off a little bit.
And with that, combat is over. What would you like to do?
I want to go look for any... Well, I'm going to go look for any, like, remains of the Bodak.
The Bodak has turned into pretty much ash. And little pieces of him are just floating away.
Okay. So there's like a pile of ash on the ground.
Yeah.
Like where he was. Would I have anything? I mean, I guess I have an empty potion bottle. Could I like scoop some Bodak ash into the...
Sure.
Say, you know, hey.
You now have Bodak ash.
We were asked to bring back interesting stuff. Evidence of a random Bodak or whatever a Bodak is. Would I know what a Bodak is?
Y'all have never seen a Bodak. Y'all have never seen a measle. So y'all have no idea what any of these things are. But with asking that question, roll me a history check at disadvantage.
Fantastic. I'm more than happy to... Wow. It's actually not miserable, but I don't think it's gonna do it. History. That's an 11.
It starts to come to you and then it goes away.
Hey, it might be a... Yeah. Never mind. I don't know.
Well, whatever these primate creatures were, I think they're our culprit for the wheat field victims.
Yeah,
with their stabbing. Would,
yeah. I'd say so. And then I would also say the necrotic one for the rotted body.
That's true. Yes.
You mean this?
In a morbid sort of way, the wounds sort of help us account for all the threats.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, because there was one that looked like it had been, like, rotted away, right? And there, yeah. And then there was, yeah. And then there was stabby guy. And then there was hole in the head guy, which we know what that's from.
Right. And that's, is that all the different ones that we there saw?
Five total, I think, right?
There was the tiefling with the short sword, the human with the hole in his skull, and three mutilated bodies with the huge gashes.
Okay, so I think...
The huge gashes could be the displacer beasts.
Yeah.
So then would we have solved everything?
You know,
Well, there's the
for
cart.
The bodies anyway?
That there was, yeah, I think...
Yeah, and there's definitely the cart, and then,
yeah.
I don't know, in this world, it's not like it's ever truly safe. I think we may have accounted for what we came out here to do, but...
None of these things make sense. Like, I don't know what these things are. I mean, I know we've seen some strange things, but having no knowledge of whatever these things that we just fought are.
And why are they? Are they native to this area, or why are they attacking?
Yeah, why did they? What drew them to the Druid Grove? Or Druid Farm, sorry. I got Baldur's Gate on my...
No, it could be a grove, it could be a farm. When you two talk about this, though, I want you to give me a history check at disadvantage.
Disadvantage.
History check.
Who is it, the two of them?
Yeah, Velfi and Friedrich, okay, since cool. They haven't done it yet.
16.
12.
With a 12, it's almost like that feeling you had earlier when you tried to recall it, and it just came to the tip of your tongue and then left. Friedrich, okay. With a 16, you get like almost little snippets and thoughts of books you've read that mention the Shadow Realm.
The Shadow Realm.
Mm-hmm.
What do they say anything about it? Or just know the term?
I guess
the question is, what makes me, of all the things I've read, what about this makes me think of that?
Kind of their parlor, like color. And the fact that when you see things like this, the atmosphere around you, for as long as you can remember, seems grayish. Nothing has much color here. It's almost like all of the colors are slightly muted, and you recall that the main colors of the Shadow Realms are grays, blacks, and anything on the grayscale.
Do I recall ever feeling this way about anywhere else we've been in the past couple weeks?
The mansion. When you fought the Beholder, when you fought talked to the Spider Children, it's almost like since everyone has been saying things are getting worse, the color is draining.
So it's like when we have these interactions with these creatures.
And since you're on the topic of it, you know that like most of your life, colors haven't really been vibrant. However, more recently, even less so.
I don't know what to make of that though. Let's see what's in those cards. Anyone wanna? I don't know. Is there a safe way to go about it? Maybe I can potentially mage hand a door open, or I don't know.
All I know is when I stood on the cart, something shifted around. So there's something in there.
Do they have like doors or windows? What are the carts? How would you get into it?
There's no windows. It's almost like the back of a truck. Like it's just got like a little pull-out bit.
Truck bed.
Yeah, like a truck bed. Even though you guys don't know what a truck is, it's very similar to a truck bed.
It's a car.
Would Kara? Do you think Kara would have any information on what's in this cart? Like no. About what they do out here.
Kara's just kind of staring at it. When you guys mention the cart, like her eyebrows are furrowed. She has no idea what's in this cart.
and we hear growling from the ether somewhere. Oh no.
Are these carts that are used in the normal operation of the farms, or do they look foreign to you?
Her eyebrows are furrowed. These are normal carts, but I don't know what could be rolling around in it. No one's missing. These are usually for like wheat transportation or potato transportation. I'm a little nervous as to what is in the cart.
Can I actually investigate the cart?
Give me an investigation check.
I'm good at investigation, apparently. That's a 24.
When you're investigating, you can see little bits of, like, ragged moving in it. And whatever is being kept in this cart right now is not wheat. It is not potatoes. And you can hear just the faintest labored breathing.
Does it sound human? Or humanoid? Or does it sound like the monkey people?
It doesn't sound like the monkeys, but you're not 100% certain if this is like a human or if this is just an animal. It doesn't seem to be as like, the movement doesn't seem to match the measles y'all just fought, but you're not 100% sure what's in it without opening it.
What needs to be opened? Is there like, is it like there's a truck drawer, like a one of the drawers in a?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like there's the truck bed clothes bit. It's almost like that, and it just needs to be pulled open.
I like look at everybody, and I kind of hold the end of the cart, and like I'm gonna open it.
I'll step back a few feet and sort of prepare myself.
Elvie's gonna be right up in there.
I'm gonna have like my weapon out just in case I get jumped by something, and I'm going to open the cart.
When you open the cart, a crossbow bolt fires out and it goes right between Velfi and Ruin. And then you quickly hear like someone trying to put another crossbow bolt in it, trying to load it up.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Do I look like a monkey?
Give me a perception check. And Velfi, if you're there and want to too, you can as well.
Okay, perfect. Because I do.
A 10.
15.
With a 10, you are going to notice that this is a young human woman. Short brown hair, very angular face. Velfi with a 15. This person's not in druid clothes.
Oh.
She's gonna fire off another crossbow bolt again. Completely missing, and it's going to go right between the two of you again as she is like trying to very rapidly trying to get this crossbow.
I'm like the weapon, her ruined sword is down, and he's like, I've got my hands up like easy.
She's got wide hazel eyes, and she looks, you can see like necrotic damage starting to like eat away at like her shoulders, the same way it was starting to like eat away at your fingertips, those of you who took a lot of damage from the bodak. You can see it's like crawling up. She's breathing very heavy as she just stares at the two of you. She looks scared shitless.
Whatever the thing in the field here is gone. I'm not trying to hurt you.
She's gonna like slowly start to look at you both. Do you both have your order pins where you can see them?
I think mine would be just right on my chest into my
outfit. Feel like Ruins would be on his, yeah.
Her crossbow is starting to wave at both of you. You're one of them. You're one of them.
I'm going to take a few steps forward toward the cart.
And she is like trying to keeping the crossbow pointed at both of you and scooting back as far as she can, like a very wounded, cornered animal.
What do you mean them? Like who do you think we are?
Your order members. Aren't you? Your order members, I come out of this thing and you're gonna kill me, right?
No.
If we wanted to kill you, we could have just left you here by yourself with the monkeys that would have gotten into the cart.
I was holding off fine on my own.
Yeah, you were handling it in a cart.
They would have gotten tired eventually.
What about this? And I hold up the, like, pile of ash that's in a... That thing would have drained your life or whatever it was doing to us. If we wanted to hurt you, we would have done it already.
What's to say you're not trying to drag me out? Roll me persuasion.
Can I roll intimidation? Because at this point, I'm like...
it depends on what you're wanting out of this. This is a very frightened, woman already.
I guess persuasion. I'm not trying to kill her. She's scared enough already. Um, 16.
She's just gonna, like, you can see her hands shaking. Step back to where I can see your hands. Both of you and anybody else that might be in here. Please.
Ruin is going to, I'm gonna reach down at my, like, belt. Was that where you keep your, wherever I keep my potions, my healing potions, and I'm going to set one on the cart and step back. It's like, you look injured. That might help.
You're going to notice almost like an animal that's trying to trust somebody slowly reach for it as she's not taking her eyes off of you both. And pretty much shoving herself right back in the back as she takes it. So what do you want? You want to take me back? Is that what this is? To wherever evil monstrosity you call a city?
You're talking about Cydonia?
It's the only city around here, right?
What happened to you in Cydonia?
What doesn't happen? They keep you in a cage, and I'm not going back to a cage.
How did you get here?
I walked.
How did they... Okay. Okay, let me understand. So you were in a cage in Cydonia, and you somehow got out here.
You don't consider yourself in a cage? What do you think the big sphere is?
Oh no, I 100% consider myself in a cage.
Then why, and she's gonna like, kinda nose, like her nose to your pins. Then why are you working for them? If you agree it's a cage.
I don't remember where I came from, and right now the only reason I'm alive is the Order. But that doesn't mean I trust them anymore.
She's gonna look at you, Velfi, and then back to you, Ruin. And you're willing to say that so open in front of another member. And since you said you don't trust them either, she's slowly going to start crawling out of the back of the box. Friedrich, what are you doing?
I am standing, I guess, between Ruin and Velfi, somewhat behind them, a few steps behind them. Watching.
And you, curious one, what are you going to do with that information?
Think about it. That's what I do with most information before I act.
And y'all are going to notice Kara. Her hands are starting to turn red. What's up, Ruin? Is that a hand raise?
Or? Oh, no, no, this is just me, like.
Kara's hands turn red?
Yeah, like she's prepping a spell.
Where is Kara?
She's standing off to the side. She has not got in front of this cart yet.
How long have you been in the cart?
Couple days now.
Are you from the farm here?
No. I want nothing to do with the druid farm. I want nothing to do with Sidonia. I want nothing to do with the Order. I want nothing to do with any of it.
And why did you get in the cart in the first place?
None of your business. I had nowhere else to go. Ruin, roll me a history check. Not at disadvantage on this one.
Oh, boy. I'm doing so well at history checks. Oh, wow. I actually did do well at history checks. At a history check. That's a 19.
With a 19, you remember when Golmak, when you asked specifically, is anyone missing that isn't a part of the Order or the Druids? He twitched, and you couldn't tell if that was to be protective of something. But you immediately think of that.
Does the name Golmak ring a bell?
What did you do to him?
Nothing. But he was protecting you.
Hearing that, Kara's gonna turn to you. What the fuck are you talking about?
Golmak. I asked Golmak if he was, or if everyone, or if there was anyone missing. And he didn't say that whoever you are, don't know your name yet, was missing. Didn't say that they were missing but wasn't telling the truth about somebody being hidden here. I don't know why he's protecting you. I don't much care.
Kara, do you know this person?
She's gonna turn her head to you. I have no idea who the fuck she is. That's the reason. She's gonna point to her hands.
I'm just gonna hold my hand out. Sort of indicate, like, just wait a moment.
So with that, Kara's very begrudgingly and almost, you start seeing frustrated tears starting to well in her eyes.
So not like a mean way, like a sort of a, hang on.
Like a...
Yeah.
Like a de-escalation and, sort of thing.
And you still see like that frustration in her face and the frustrated tears starting to well, because like, she found out the stuff from yesterday. She was angry this morning. And now there's this person who she doesn't know in a cart claiming all of these sorts of things. So it's almost like she's just extremely frustrated and you could see it in her face. And the woman in the cart slowly pulls herself out. And she, but before she quite gets to the end of it, she's just going to look at the three of you. I hope you know, if you kill me, I will haunt you for the rest of your life. I will find a way to become a fucking ghost, and I will haunt you for the remainder of whatever eternity is in this shithole!
Fair enough.
Well said.
If you wanted to be a ghost, there's ways to make that happen.
I don't want to be a ghost. What do you not understand about this whole situation? I've been in this damn car for 2 days. I just don't want to die yet. But if I do die because you decide to kill me, then I will become a ghost and I will haunt you.
I'm haunted by enough ghosts. You can just then add another one more to the stack. Fantastic.
Okay, and she's gonna slowly drag herself. She's got a lot of spunk considering she's been in here for 2 days, and you can tell like she's having like the necrotic damage she's had has started to recede just a bit since you gave her a health potion, and she's still got her crossbow, and she's going to slowly pull herself out. This woman's got, again, short brown hair, very angular face, hazel eyes, very short, very, very short. She's like 5 foot tall.
Oh God, so I'm a solid like 2 feet taller than she
she's
is.
She's little. You can tell she's about 23, 24. Now what?
So what? Why is Golmak protecting you? You can start, or actually, you know what? What's your name?
Gully.
We can start there. I'm sorry, what?
Gully. My name's Gully. G-U-L-L-Y.
Fantastic. I'm just writing that down in my notebook. It's fine.
Where's the notebook go?
In my pocket.
Why is it going? What do you do with it when you put it in your pocket? Where is it going? Like, where do you go afterward?
It goes into the void. I don't know. It sits in my pocket.
Who do you plan on sharing this with?
Nobody.
Then why did you write it down?
Because I forget names easily.
Forget it then! That's a good thing! And she's just staring at you, and I mean, like, again, she is 5 foot tall, so she is, like, staring up at you. She's got her little crossbow. Her finger's not on the trigger anymore, but she's got her little crossbow, like, pointed up.
Why do you distrust the Order?
Who the fuck wouldn't? They keep you all in this little tiny ass city with a big ass sphere on it, and if you don't do what you like they want you to, they tell you where to go, what to do, they give you tiny ass little maps, and that's it.
Did they do that to you?
She's gonna get very quiet.
You already said that you're a fellow order member.
I never said that.
Really? Let's backtrack for a second. You were in the cart. I told you that I don't trust the order, and you said, oh, you'd really say that in front of another member.
I was talking about her. And she's gonna like nudge her head to Velfi.
She already knows that I don't really trust the order anymore.
And they let you freely say that.
I look over at Velfi, it's like, you gonna kill me?
Your opinions are your own.
There you go.
If it gets back to the order that you think that they will kill you on the spot, you realize that, right?
As far as the order is concerned, we're already dead unless we go back.
Not unless they have proof.
So it's not just a dislike on general principle. You are a quote-unquote victim of the order, is that right?
You all are. Now, the fact that you don't see it that way is very concerning.
I'm asking about you.
I want all of you to give me a perception check.
Perception?
14.
23.
8.
With an 8, you don't see it. However, with a 14 and a 23, you both notice she's missing a few fingers. And it's very neatly cut.
So, Belfie's gonna look at her hands, say, did that happen in the order?
Give me a persuasion check.
14.
And she slowly turns her crossbow to you. They need proof of death, right?
Yes.
Would they expect you to cut your phone fingers off and give it back to him? Have you ever had to hunt one of your own?
I've killed one of our own.
Because they told you to?
They were infected.
So just because you're you're infected, there's no chance of saving you?
Not so far that we've found.
So just because you get infected, instead of at least trying, they send their own to go kill them? Even if they're not a part of the walls? Even if they're out here on their own?
That is exactly why I joined the Order. Was to find a cure. Was to find a way to prevent this from happening and stop the death, stop the dying, maybe even reverse. But where we are right now, we still need to gather way more information. We don't know what's happening, and we need to solve it.
How can you find a cure if you kill the people that are infected immediately without studying it?
That's why we come out and we gather information. The professor and I are both from the schools. We take that knowledge and we learn from what we discover outside.
You give them information from the outside. Have they ever given you any?
No.
And let me guess, they tell you there's no one else outside the walls either.
Yes.
Sounds like you're a little bird in a cage, doesn't it?
Belfie's just gonna step back and maybe just think about things for a second.
I'm gonna reach into my pocket and pull out the dead order member pin. Dead. That's how it's written in my inventory. And just hold it out in my palm and say, is this familiar to you?
In terms of what it looks like, I know what it is.
Is it yours?
That one specifically, no.
But you've had one?
Roll me a persuasion check.
Twelve.
I was going to say, could I give him the help action by pulling out the rest of the order pins that I have in my inventory?
Sure, roll with advantage.
Help me.
Pick one.
The first one was 12. The next one is...
Here are my wares.
I rolled the same thing twice. 12.
Well, I tried. I still am like pulling out the order, like the stack of order pins.
She's just going to get distracted by the fact that you're pulling out order pins. Are you collecting them now or something? And she's going to completely ignore your question.
These were the collection of a mind flayer. It was way over there, and I point roughly in the direction of the orchards.
And it's gone?
It's beyond gone.
Wonderful. We won't have to worry about that later. And she's still like, you can tell she's still very nervous. She's a little more comfortable around Ruin. She's still wary of both Velfi and Friedrich. And she keeps looking over at Kara like she's expecting Kara to explode.
Can I like clock that she's kind of like looking at Kara like she's going to explode?
Kind of like, as in, like, she's scared Kara's going to, like, attack her.
Okay.
You asked my companion here if she had ever hunted or killed another Order member. Have you done that?
Roll me a persuasion.
Not helping you this time, Professor. It's all on you.
18.
She rolled a nat one. I don't know of any past, present, or future order member that will not be sent on those kind of orders. And I will not do it anymore. And I haven't for years. Because again, with those fingers, y'all notice that they are very well healed. She just doesn't have them.
Wait, so what was her response again?
Past, present, and future order members will receive those orders. And I'm not doing it anymore. I haven't done it in years.
So how long have you been out here?
3 years.
Golmec has been hiding you at great risk to himself.
Roll me a persuasion check to see how much you get out of her.
While Ruin's asking, I'm going to cast Detect Thoughts on her.
Are you just doing surface thoughts?
Just surface level thoughts, yeah. Because I don't want to know I'm doing it.
Okay. With surface level thoughts,
13.
You get... I'm scared. I will not go back. They cannot make me. And if they force me, then this is where I will make my last stand. I'm not going back to a cage. I just want to go home.
So even with Ruin asking that question. Okay.
With a 13, she rolled a 5. I just came to ask for supplies. Look, and she's gonna start like scrounging through like her pants and everything, and she's gonna pull out a little gold bag. It is all I have. But take it and never mention me to anybody, because if you do, more than just me are in danger. And she's going to take, like, pull your hand open, Ruined, put the, like, bag of gold in it. I don't exist. Make sure it stays that way, please.
Would we have, like, our supplies on us?
That's up to you. Like, do you carry them or do you leave them on the horses?
Yeah, I would have left them on the horses. I was just like, I was going to be like, if I had rations, I'd just give her one of the rations. But I'm going to hand the gold back to her. Like, I'm not going to accept it.
She's going to take it back and then give it to Friedrich, since he's been asking her a lot of questions. Keep my name and my existence out of your thoughts, out of your mouth, out of your sentences, everything. Do not, please.
We don't want or need your money. But why did you join the order originally?
Roll me a persuasion.
She's a tough cookie.
Lots of persuading. Oh, no.
That's
a
5.
That's a 3. Only order members can leave.
So
did you know where you were headed when you joined the order?
Roll me persuasion.
Oobly.
And the DC for this is probably going to be really high.
That is a natural 20, which would be a 25.
There are a lot of rumors. I followed the rumors.
I'm going to give you this gold back, and I just want you to think, if you joined the order to use them toward your own ends, that would be escape from the sounds of it. It's possible other people have their own reasons, maybe similar, for joining the order. I'll hand the gold back to her.
So are you saying you want to escape too?
I'm saying the order and membership within it can be a means to an end.
She's just going to kind of look at each of you. And her eyes are going to land on Velfi for just a moment. And then she's just going to shake her head and go back to kind of glancing around. If they find out I exist, they find out traitors exist, they're gonna come after us all. And Ruin, in your head,
traitor, your orders are to kill them on sight, weren't they?
Ruin's gonna like just turn around and walk away.
And in your head again.
Are you directly disobeying me?
Give me a wisdom saving throw.
An 8.
With an 8, you start to feel your body and your hands moving towards where your sword is. But it's when you put your hand on the hilt, it's almost like you're able to just hold it there without it moving. And it's almost like you're at a stalemate. But you can hear this thing screaming in your head. Traitor, 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 over and over again as you've just got your hand on your hilt.
I feel like Ruin, like, out loud would, like, scream, I'm not doing this again!
What is everybody doing when they hear that?
Do we see his hand still on his weapon?
Roll, if you want to be sneaky with it, roll me a stealth check. If you're just kind of standing there with it.
I don't think he's even trying. I don't think he would know to be sneaky about
it. Okay. Do you wear long sleeves or short sleeves?
I would probably wear long sleeves because I'm hiding the where I had gotten. Like, so it would be long sleeves. Or like, you know, kind of wrist length, I guess.
Do you wear gloves?
I don't believe so.
So you will notice that those little black veins that you got from that injection point have started coming down to your hands.
Does it look similar to what, like, the veins that were on Arlo?
Very similar.
I feel like Ruin would, like, this sword's going to come out, but the blade is pointed, like, directly at him.
Don't you dare.
I need you to make a wisdom saving throw.
Terribly now. It's a 9.
You're going to feel your fingers loosen and your sword's going to drop. And it's going to just hit the floor with a, or the ground with like a thud. And Gully and Kara are just, they're both turning their heads towards you. And Gully is going to look at both Friedrich and Velfi. Does he just normally walk off and yell at the sky like this? Is this a normal thing, or is this like new?
So Velfi has been like deep in thought, and I think she kind of only has, she's like, she noticed what happened and what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
She's not like totally like focused on it. So she's gonna say, he gets in his own head sometimes. That's what I think anyway.
And you're gonna notice Gully looks over to Friedrich as she's really lost in thought for a second, and she's almost expecting Friedrich to say something. Cause she asked both of you a question.
Is he still standing there holding his
swords on the ground?
Swords on the ground. And you will also notice Kara's gonna go over and she's gonna slap the back of Ruin's head and cast a spell magic. We aren't doing this today. And you're gonna feel like some of that receding. And she's just staring directly at you.
Do I feel like I have, like, control of my...
The minute her hand collides with the back of your head, you feel like you're gaining control again. And she's like, we're not doing this today. Like, almost like... And the tone behind it is with that frustrated tear sound. Like, I'm not losing someone else.
And I feel like Ruin were, or I'm going to, like, start walking in a random direction. The sword is laying on the ground. Like, I'm not reaching down to pick it up. And I'm walking.
Kara's going to pick his sword up and start walking after him. And it's a little heavy for her. She's short. She's not, like, super tall and super strong or anything. She's a druid. So she's kind of like just dragging it behind. Like, when I said not today, I didn't mean leave me behind either. She is just like walking and hobbling with this sword, and it just leaves Gully and Velfi and Friedrich.
When Kara slapped Ruin upside the head and cast this dispel magic, was there any sort of indication that she had cast a spell?
Being a magic user, give me an arcana check. I had advantage.
Oh. Still not that great. 14?
Yeah, you know that she cast something. Because it's almost like that bitter taste that you got when you were at the mansion.
Yeah.
Like something very similar to that disappeared. Like, you got it for a second, and then it went away.
I just wanted to clock that. I'm not going to act on it, but I wanted to see if I could tell if it was... If she's just, like, get a grip, or actually dispelling some type of magic that is...
You could tell
affecting him.
That was more than just a get a grip. That was very much like, I'm not losing someone else right now. Snap out of it. Like, I'm pulling you back if I have to.
Gully?
I think that's my cue to leave.
Yeah, and we're not here for you. You're not a target. You're not. We didn't even know you were here. You're obviously free to go wherever you wish to. As you requested, we didn't meet you, but We do need to report back on the farm here. We wouldn't want to draw any undue attention here. I take it you won't stick around here long.
Oh no, my idea is to run as soon as this conversation's over. I am out. That was my plan to start with, and then all this happened. So yeah, as soon as this is over, I'm gone. You will never see me again. You will never hear from me again. Hopefully. But then she just kind of stares for a second. But everybody joins the order for a reason. So maybe it won't be my last time seeing you. And she's going to take the money back and she's going to put it in Velfi's hand. Little bird, don't say anything. And she's going to take off.
Can Velfi just try to stop her from running?
Roll me a sleight of hand check.
What is my sleight of hand? Where are you? That's a 7.
You just grasp the back of her shirt and it just goes through your fingers as she literally like turns around and poof, gone.
Is it... Can I take off after her?
Sure.
Okay. I'm running.
As she's running, she's hearing your footsteps behind her. I thought I was free to go. Did you change your mind all of a sudden? Was it not enough gold? That's literally all I have.
No. I have one question for you.
She's gonna slow down. Okay.
Do the names Lorelei and Karis mean anything?
Roll me a persuasion check.
Agent. That is a nat 20 plus 6.
Oh, shit.
Let's go!
All right. You're getting a little bit more lore than I expected this early. She's gonna pause for a second. And you're gonna see tears come to her eyes. Lorelei was a wonderful person. And what happened to her was a real shame. I was there when it happened, you know?
What happened?
She got bit. Got infected. And Karis told us to run. Find the raiders as soon as we could.
Find the raiders?
She said raiders, but she's not going to elaborate.
Okay.
He joined soon after. And has been, for some fucking reason, hell-bent getting back into Sedania.
Wait. Are you telling me that Karis is alive?
I go on runs with Karis quite often.
You mean to tell me that my dad has been alive this whole time?
That's why you look familiar. And she's gonna sit there for a second. And you're gonna see tears well in her eyes for a second. You're the reason he's so hell-bent on getting back into Sedania. And It's almost like her heart breaks. I can't bring you with me. Not yet. But do know Karis has been trying to find a way to get to you. For the last 2 years.
Well,
something big is happening for Sidonia. Be ready for it. And she's going to take off.
So, Belfi is going to, she's going to just slowly walk back to where the professor is.
Is it, how much of Belfi's feelings is she wearing on her face right now?
Well, she's been crying, so you would be able to see that her face is puffy. She's got this really, really complex look on her face, brow furrowed, just keeping her eyes to the ground, like she's got a million and one things going on in her head.
I'm just going to hold my hand out and say, are you okay?
No. I'm not. Everything that I've thought has been turned on its head. My dreams that I've been having, she Gully more or less confirmed what I've been remembering, what I've been dreaming about. My father is still alive.
Friedrich's just gonna look off, almost like looking past her at Gully. What is Gully doing?
Gully is booking it, so she is quickly turning into a tiny little figure going towards, like, the skyline.
I'm just going to hold my gaze there for a moment and then turn it back to Velfi. And just say, what do you need right now?
I need this to stay between us.
It's done.
Thank you. I have a lot to think about. That's all I need from you right now. Is your trust, your silence. I'll even give you this bag of gold.
No. I don't exchange gold with friends and confidants. There's no price to my loyalty. We can talk when you're ready.
All right.
That bag of gold has 300 gold pieces in it.
Girl. I'm gonna go get a new dress.
Retail therapy.
Honestly. So, Velfi, she's gonna wipe her tears, give like a sad smile, and say, so, should we check on Ruin? You know, he almost killed himself.
Yeah, it's going to look like Friedrich forgot that anything else was going on here. And as I turn, like, oh, to look towards Kara and Ruin, and are they still sort of holding what they were doing?
Oh, Ruin has been walking in a direction.
And Kara is pretty much trying to follow after you. And she's just dragging this thing. Do you want to talk about it? It'd be great if you came to get your sword. This shit's heavy. I don't like carrying it, but I'm pretty sure you don't have anything else to attack with, so it might be a good idea. And she's like just frustrated, crying and carrying this sword around, to come get this piece of shit. Not make me have to walk around with it by myself.
She's like, yelling that. And then Ruin, because it's my packed weapon, is going to, like, attempt, I don't know how it's going to work right now, to call my packed weapon to me.
It does not come to you.
And he just kind of looks at his hand.
And in your head is eerily silent.
And...
roll me an intelligence check.
That's a great idea for me right now. Because I am such a smart. Many much smarts. That is cocked. Thank God, because that was halfway to a 3. That's an 8.
With an 8.
I don't have a ton of intelligence.
A fleeting thought comes by that maybe the thing you made a pact with isn't a good thing.
Yeah. You know, in Ruin's head, he's like, yeah, yeah. Should have kind of figured with all the masks. And he's going, like, I'm going to stop so Kara can catch up, because I'm 7 feet tall, so I'm walking a little bit further than she is, or faster than she is.
And she finally catches up.
Like,
and she's huffing and puffing. You're like a foot and a half taller, man. That means your legs are a lot longer than my little ones.
And Ruin is like, I'm still kind of staring forward, and I just like reach down and grab the sword from her.
Thank you. That was getting a little hot. A little too hot for my liking. You know, I like water. It's very hard being a fucking like fire user when you're a water damn genasi. Anyway, what can I do for you? You look like you need something, and I'm not very sure that I am very good at offering anything, but I wanted to provide my services if I could do anything for you, because you look like shit.
I don't want to be a monster anymore.
And she's just gonna, like, very...
And I'm going to, like, pull my sleeve up that has the veins on it, because you said they like kind of pulled back. I'm assuming they're still there.
Yeah. Well, what did that to you?
What do you think?
And she's
the same thing, the same place that took your sister.
She's just gonna kind of sigh for a second. You know, that's the reason I never went with her, right? I never wanted to be a part of the Order. Always. Something just doesn't sit right. They did that to you? How many other people have they done this to?
There's an entire... I was in the thing with the masks.
Yep.
I know that I saw a bunch of them, but I don't know.
You saw Chameleon. You saw owl.
One, two, three, four.
Crow. Wolf. Cat. Bear. And dragon.
And the priest who brought me there.
Ignitius.
And wherever that voice and the disembodied voice that has controlled every decision that I've made.
Yep, there was that thing hanging from the ceiling, and there was also the cloaked man in the slate and black robes that you never saw as or her face.
So I would list all of those off. This was to help me help my friends, and look what that's done.
And she's just gonna tilt her head a bit and then just look up at you and specifically look you in your eyes. I don't think that a monster would have done that to protect his friends. So while this outcome may not be what you want, I do not consider you a monster. Monsters. And she's gonna look back to where you guys walked from. Monsters are the things that we just saw there. Monsters are the things, and she's gonna look back at your arm, that do that. I think there is a world of difference in that and you. You're not a monster. It just sounds like you have done things to try to make the best out of the situation with what you had. I think there's a different term for that, and I think it's called survival. Which, considering everything that we have had happened to us in the 152 years, I think you're just doing the best that you can with what you're given. And she's just gonna kind of there's this just not a smirk, but a little half smile on her face. If you want. She doesn't really answer, at least not me. There's a little place outside of the Druid's Grove that I think you may be interested in, if you want to see it.
I'd look down at my arm, and for the first time, Ruin has emotion on his face, and starting to tear up. It's anything is better than this.
She's gonna nod and very gently grab your hand, but almost she's worried of scaring you, and just very gently start pulling you along. And she's going to take you past the Druid's Grove, the little Druid farm, past where the little circle is, the sphere is. So you guys are still outside of it, and she's going to bring you to, it almost looks like a big sphere. Like a sphere of vines and grass and all kinds of nature that has created this ball. And she's gonna just look at it for a second. And gently point, let go of your hand and gently point to it. The password to get in is Elnora. Maybe what you seek, what you need is in there. But I think this is a journey best taken by walking it alone.
And I just nod my head and walk forward. And you said it was Elnora?
Elnora. And she's still going to stand there, but once you say Elnora, it's almost like this wooden nature ball just opens up a tiny hole. Well, not too tiny, but enough for you to, just enough for you to get through. And once you walk through, you get this warm feeling like you're being embraced. And a bright light just encases you. And before we continue that, Velfi and Friedrich, what are you two up to?
Well, having heard all that commotion, I think I would just turn to Velfi and say, if there's anything else out here that wants to kill us, Kara is keen to let it know we're out here because she's screaming at the top of her lungs. And I feel like maybe we should catch up before something else decides it doesn't want us here.
I think you're right. I think we should muster the courage and catch up.
Mayonnaise is really a reason I like you. Anyway, I relish this opportunity. Okay, I'm done. Yeah, shall we?
Yeah. Yeah. Let's go. So I guess we start walking in the direction that they headed.
Yeah. Are they trying to be, does she seem to be secretive about it, or does she look like she intends for us to follow, or?
So you could have heard her screaming as like chasing after him, but you two do not have sights on them anymore. And you know they were walking in the direction of the Druid Grove, but after that, you don't know where they went.
I guess we just go where we last heard them. What do you think?
I guess maybe we can follow their footprints if they left any. Are you a tracker?
I'm not much for tracking, but Ruin's a big guy. I imagine he's not too discreet in his tracks.
Because I can see this line here.
I also kind of feel like Ruin's like footsteps were like somebody who's kind of like dragging their feet, like kind of like dragging themselves through sand, like their feet are, you know, weighted down.
If you both are tracking Ruin, give me a perception check to see if you see Ruin's footprints.
I'm trying to think if I had anything that would make it like, oh, I'm good at this.
Oh no.
Perception
check. I got a 7.
No pressure. Oh, I got a 6.
So even though Ruin has been like almost like the word of the world is on his shoulders, you two get distracted by something. Like, oh, look at that. It seems like the Druid Grove's like coming back a little bit. And then you look kind of back and then like, you can't tell the difference between what's a like wheel track versus where the footsteps of Ruin went. Like it's a little well trodden. Like you just can't quite tell where Ruin went.
Are we out in the field?
Yes.
I cast fly on myself.
Okay.
And you'll see I just shoot up 60 feet into the air. But first, I'll be right back. And I shoot up into the air. Can I see anything from there?
Give me a perception check. You see the tail end of Ruin and Kara going into like a slightly wooded area that's a little ways off from the Druid Grove. And you can tell with that, it's almost like she's very gently guiding him somewhere.
Okay. I'm going to slowly sort of descend back down to the ground and say, I think I know where they went. They seem to be in this direction. And just guide Velfi that way.
So you two would make it to where Kara and Ruin are. Ruin just walked into the dome, and it's almost like a bright light is coming from the opening, and then it seals and the bright light goes away. And this is as you are walking up.
So like we're sealed out of it?
You are sealed out of it.
And Kara's standing like right outside.
Mm-hmm. Kara is just very calmly. She has her like arms like not like crossed, but like she's just holding her hands in front of her. She does look very calm.
Is Ruin in there?
She's gonna kind of shake her head. Yeah, he's in there. I'm sure he'll be out in a minute. But I think this might be a good time to give him some peace.
Yeah, I mean, is it like a, we're in a wooded area?
It's slightly wooded.
Is it like a tree stump, a fallen log, something I can sit down on? Yeah, I'm an old man, and I'm hassling for breath at this point.
There's plenty of carved seats in this area, and you will notice that this area is the most vibrant you all have probably seen in your entire life. Like the muted tones that are in normal life. It's like seeing all new colors for the first time.
Does this place hold some significance to the Druids, Kara?
Yes. The protection area that Golmak has mentioned bringing us all to is this place. Golmak puts a lot of his energy and probably his life force into this. It's a sanctuary, if you will.
I just nod, just listening to whatever she'll say.
And while this is happening, Ruin, when you go into the circle and it closes behind you, it takes a little while for your vision to come back, as that was really bright. But this place is warm and not like overly humid or hot. It's almost like it's the perfect temperature. And you're in a vastly wooded forest with the greenest trees you have ever seen. This is a green in your memory you have never seen before. It's very bright. And there are a bunch of like logs that have carved little seats in them, and all circling a big oak tree that's in the center. And you'll notice that there are more seats and pews and things like that on the opposite end of the tree. So what do you want to do?
I would sit down in like one of the sit down on one of the seats, kind of not picking one in particular, and like stare down at my sword that's now just right now just a long sword. Like there's nothing, you know, it was this like black jagged, you know, and now it's just a sword.
In your, I don't even want to say in your head, it's almost like a gentle breeze comes by and caresses your face. It's a very strange feeling because wind doesn't normally do that. And you almost feel like something play, like twirl, like your hair. And then you see little leaves flowing around the tree to the other side, where there's more pews.
I would just leave my sword on the ground and follow the leaves, I guess.
And as you follow these leaves, they're very green and very bright, and the air around this area smells fresh. Like there is no rot, there is no decay, and there is no like slight bitterness that your world has had for as long as your memory like can, as far as you can go back. This is all brand new. These feelings are all brand new. It feels very loving here. Like it's been taken care of and cherished, and like somebody loves this place a lot. And when you go around the other side in the oak tree, you see this is a huge oak tree. And in the bottom of it, there is a huge carving. It's very delicate, very beautiful. And there is a woman sitting in the center that has been carved into it. You see little bits of nature just all around her, carved into this oak tree. And she's got her hands together like this between, like right in the middle of her chest, and her eyes are closed. And this person that has been carved in this tree just looks very at peace.
I would like sit down, almost kneel down, like on my, not the kneel like you're getting knighted, kneel like somebody who's just out of energy, and just almost just like put my head on the ground and cry, openly cry. And like all of the emotions that are coming out are, I've never had control. I went from being a, like the thoughts of what Gully had said about being a bird in a cage. I went from one cage, I traded one cage for another cage for another cage.
You're going to feel that breeze again. And it's just going to like very gently swirl around you. And again, like a weird caress from wind is just very strange. And like something just twirls like your hair. And you're gonna feel almost like a gentle hand on the back of your shoulder. And small little circles, very comforting, almost motherly circles on the back of your back, in the center of your back. K, pages aren't a natural feeling, are they?
No, but I have no way out of this one. And I look down at my arm, or at the like veins that are...
There is always another way out. If you just look. And you still feel these gentle circles.
I would kind of look up and see if there's anything, or because I'm like, I don't know if I'm just like looking up into nothing, or
when you look up, you see the carving of the woman in front of you in this oak tree, and at the bottom, and like very elegant writing, Drisana. Mother of everything natural.
Don't. I don't know. I don't think Ruin knows how to express that, like being in like the, you know, seeing all of the colors and everything that he's never seen before. Like, I mean, it's bright, it's like for the first time in his entire like life, he kind of feels free. Like that this is his choice, not something that was forced on him, or that he has a choice.
And you're just gonna, this person is still just rubbing circles, like very comforting, and hasn't left. That feeling is my favorite. Feeling free is a natural thing. Your world, your piece of it, anyway, is not. If you want help, I can be of assistance, but this will drain me. So I will need a lot from you. But I will never take from you. The only thing I ask in return is you fix what is not natural.
your previous patron is not natural. It is not kind. It is not from your realm. The only thing I ask is you destroy what it creates, so life can continue the way it is supposed to. I will not take, but I just ask.
Ruin, I, without hesitation, whatever that is, needs to be dealt with.
It took much from you. If you agree, what you have lost will come back slowly, slowly. This will not be easy.
I've done easy. I'm done with easy. What do I need to do?
Do you agree to a patronage with me?
Yes.
I will rid it from you. It will not affect you again, but be mindful. It will be spiteful. It will be very angry, for it is not natural. Do you still agree?
And when you nod, you're going to feel a motherly presence wrap her arms around you and give you a tight squeeze before it slowly dissipates. And this weight that you have felt on your shoulders disappears. You look down at your arm, and the black veins start to disappear and slowly go back to the point of injection. And you're actually going to see a small hole open. And that black ooze that was injected into you a few sessions ago is going to slowly come out and like hang in the air in front of you before it disintegrates and turns to ash.
It is done. I will never take. I will only ask. But I can only... And you can tell that her voice is getting weaker. Do this once. And then that hug that you're feeling is just going to disappear.
And I feel like Rua, or I'm going to like look at my hand for a second and think about it. And then I know my sword is on the other side of the, and I'm going to attempt to like call it back to me.
And when you attempt to call it back, it is no longer the sword that you remember. It is still a long sword, but the hilt looks like it's been made out of an oak tree. Very elegant design, very natural design, with leaves and vines carved into the hilt. And the, I don't know what it's called, the little ball on the hilt that's at the end.
Pommel.
I used to know that was called.
Is it a pommel?
Yeah.
I think that's it.
Yeah, the pommel's the bottom, yeah.
It's going to have the carving of the face that you are staring at in front of you. Like a very simple carving of that. The blade is no longer jagged and black. It is now an extremely bright green. And it almost waves like wind. And you get, when you hold this weapon now, this packed weapon, a sense of love and care and hope. When the past one only allowed for dread, hate, and anger.
And I'd look down at it, and just for the first time looking at a weapon, like, I knew what it was for before. Like, it was obvious what it was meant to do before. And just smile and put it into my, like, the scabbard? Is that the right word? Yeah.
Yeah, sheath, scabbard.
Sheath, scabbard, you know, whatever. And I know, like, I know which direction I came from.
Yeah. Right? And there's actually, like, a little, like, wind breeze that's carrying some bright green leaves towards the door as well. Like, almost, like, escorting you out. And you just get this sense that it's saying, good luck.
I make my way out, and I feel like a lot of, you know, like, I feel like Ruin's armor is a little brighter. Like, a lot of what I wore was, like, dark, you know, black, like, really, like, I don't want him to come out, like, shining, like, you know, but, you know, when he walks out, it's definitely, like, changed. Maybe there's more green or something like that in it to just kind of not be so dark and scary looking anymore.
And when you walk out, Kara is just gonna stand there. She's been like staring at the entry point. Huh. Green actually might be your color.
That would, like, without even a word, I walk up and hug Kara.
Oh, hug. I don't know how I feel about this. Ha. And she's like awkwardly like doing the like the hug back and the like the patting.
The pat of like, I'm not really comfortable hugging you, but
not okay. Necessarily that she's not comfortable. Kara doesn't get many hugs. It's more so like she's uncomfortable. She's not a hugger. But, like, that's not specifically to you. She's just, it's almost like she doesn't hug very often.
Yeah.
But she's trying to put like love and care into this hug as much as she awkwardly can.
And I'd like, it was like a quick like hugger, and then I'm like, is like, I like pull her back and just, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. I'm glad that she spoke to you. I don't sense that she can speak to many.
And Velfi and Friedrich, you guys see this as well, since y'all are there. And you will notice the greens that Ruin mentioned are the brightest greens you have ever seen.
You look refreshed.
That's a phrase. That's a word for it. Is Gully free?
Gully is gone.
Do I notice anything about like Velfi? Yeah.
Would
I
know,
like, do I see any sort of, because I know I've been gone for a little while, so I don't want to assume that
I'd say like her face is still a little puffy, but she's looking a bit more normal, but she is acting a bit more reserved than usual. But she's not really giving too much away.
I'd look at Velfi and just say, I'm sorry I've been so whatever I've been the last day. You almost died, and that was my fault.
Velfi, she's gonna look up at Ruin and say, none of that was your fault. No matter what you think, no matter what you believe to be true, none of it was your fault. You saved me. And I want you to remember that. Despite everything else, you saved me.
Oh, well, what's next? We've got a lot of...
I think there's like a visible like,
yeah,
sigh with everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Y'all are gonna notice Tara just kind of party.
Before we do that, do I feel like I could be able to like bring up the stuff that I couldn't before because my old patron wouldn't let me?
With like, Trisana. She always, like she just said, she will always ask. She will never take.
Okay. So I'm going to, like, as we're walking, I was like, I'm going to tell Kara, party sounds fantastic. And like, as we're walking, I'm going to like spill everything, like the whole... like I had a hood put on my head, went down into the don't know exactly where it was, somewhere in the city, that black goop that we got, I think is something that gives power but locks people into whatever the thing was that was control or was my patron was the person I got my power from. And spill my guts about the masks. Because they did say I was part of, I was one of the masks, or I was part of the masks, or something like that, right? If they I did. Remember that far back.
They did. We'll see what happens after today, though.
I'm just going to take it all in. Right now, I think the only connection that Friedrich would be able to make is, hey, I think we met one of those masked people once.
And in Ruin's retelling, Fox was not there.
And that doesn't mean that he wasn't part of it, or that he...
Yeah, y'all just know he was not there. Whether that means he's good or bad, you don't know.
But he is the only mask, at least that Friedrich has met.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I saw them. I don't recall that any of them spoke.
Mm-mm.
Like, the only person that spoke was my patron, whoever that was. And I saw the priest that brought me in, so this, I guess, was their plan, since they saved me.
So perhaps Gully is on to something.
Perhaps.
Perchance.
And with that, as you all are making your way back to the Grove, talking about things that happened, wherever they happened, and about this new person named Gully, that's where we're going to end tonight's episode.
I feel like I need to go watch something funny.
You all get to level up as well.
Trauma level.
Trauma levels, yay!